My
Yeah,
screen.
there we
Oh.
go. Hello, hello, and welcome to the new edition of Mind Debates. I know it's been more than a couple of months, but we were waiting for the right occasion to come back, and here we are back. So we apologize for the gap in between the last two debates, but this is a particularly exciting one. We've been wanting to have this for a long time, and glad that this is happening. So we have two special guests on the debate today. Of course, it's going to be me and Pramod from the Mindmakers team. Sadly, Sunanda could not make it today because she had to travel somewhere. But together today we have Shri Dattatreya Hozaballe, who is the current Sahasrakariwa of the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. He's hailing from Shimoga in Karnataka, and he is the protege of the former late secretary H.V. Seshadri. He has a background in English literature, and he's the current, if you did not know the Sahasrakariwa, that means he's the current Joint General Secretary of the RSS. I'll go on to Dattaji in just a minute. Before that, I want to introduce our next guest. Today we also have Advaita Kala, who is an award-winning screenwriter and an author and a columnist. She's based out of Delhi and Uttarakhand. Pleased to have you both. First of all, I want to go to Dattaji. Hello, Dattaji. Nice to have you on Mind Hangouts.
Sure.
So Advaita, any initial comments you want before we start the question and answer in the discussion session?
I think holy processions are setting the tone of this conversation. I think it's an honor to be here and to engage with Dattaji and get his views on a lot of things, because the RSS has been in the news a lot, but especially in the last 1 week, some interesting developments. So it would be interesting to get his perspective on what's going on.
Absolutely. So to set the tone of the debate, one thing, me and Pramod have talked about this for a lot of time, lot of times on the record and off the record. Last week we were recording a podcast about the RSS 2.0, or the evolution of the Sangh as we are seeing. And one thing that has been the media strategy or the media appearance of the Sangh were far and few. And I always wanted, to have more of them, and for the Sangh leaders to interact more. And we saw that, we saw Dattaji going to the India Today conclave last week, and an increase in that. So do you think we can expect more of that in the near future, Dattaji?
See, Sangh is always it's open, and anytime we have been right from the days of Guruji Golwalkar have been addressing the media, same thing with Balasaheb Devaras and all others. Regularly during the tour, once in a year or twice in a year, they were addressing. And last 10 years back, we have started our Prachar Vibhag also. There has been media interaction is not a new thing. However, India Today Conclave and others, they have also not invited us in the past. Of course, they have been trying. It all depends on our organization, timetable, etc. There was no, we do not want to shun media. We are not hesitant to interact with media. And you have seen last year I was there with Indian Express Thinkajou Conclave in Chennai. And at least 3-4 times in a year, I addressed the press. Last September, when there was Samanwaya Baithak in Delhi, I addressed the media. And as you said, therefore, yesterday I was there in India Today Conclave. And some other media people also have been contacting, and regularly we have been giving interviews. And our Prachar Vibhag, Manmohan Vaidya and others, they are there. And in each state, our state office bearers are also addressing the press with regular frequency. So it is there. And you can definitely expect, because RSS is in the center stage of the nation's life, and definitely more media people are taking interest, and we are also not very indifferent to media. They are welcome to talk to us, and we are happy to interact with them.
Absolutely. That's great to hear. Before I come to you, Pramod, what Dattaji brought up was an interesting point, that the RSS did suffer from an ideological apartheid almost, because you had the media narrative in India dominated by the left liberal discourse. And slowly we are seeing even that change. So that is a very interesting point, that you know there were quote-unquote lit fests where only people like us were invited. Like, I don't mean us, people like them were invited. And the RSS would never have a representation and so forth. So that was an interesting thing. But Pramod, you wanted to make a point before I go
Dattaji,
to Advaita.
Dattaji, and I also want Advaitaji's comment eventually after Dattaji, is there is a general perception that not a whole lot of literature is available, whether it is in English or in vernacular languages, about the work done by Sangha in, let us say, Nepal relief. I'm just giving that as an example. Can there be more effort from the Sangha to make the literature in terms of books, in terms of write-ups, in terms of case studies available on projects undertaken by the Sangh for wider dissemination, so that people are now very internet savvy. They don't really have to go and watch television channel to know about Sangh. But can there be more wider knowledge available about the Sangh in the future?
Definitely, this Sangh has been publishing its literature for decades now. Of course, those literature were mainly, they were addressed to our cadre and our sympathizers, well-wishers, etc. For the general public also, we have published a lot of literature, right? For example, Rashtrottan Parishat, Loki Prakashan, Kurukshetra Prakashan. For example, Kurukshetra Prakashan has been one of the prominent organizations in Kerala, Cochin. They have been organizing every year international book fair. A Sangha organization is organizing the book fair. And it's one of the prominent book fairs in the country. And we have been participating in such book fairs everywhere. Only thing is, because there has been, as it rightly put it, an ideological apartheid, so that's why Sangha has not been able to push into those areas where the ideological thinking and discussion takes place regularly. However, it is also for the Sangha to come out with more of literature, as you said, about the seva activities and many of the other areas of, and dimensions of Sangha activity. Hmm. And as far as the internet presence is concerned, more of content creation is required. And in the recent years, for the last 3 to 6 months, we have been working on that more of internet content should be created as far as the Sangha and inspired organizations activities are concerned in our country elsewhere. So this should be done. I do admit that a lot has to be done on this front.
Hmm. Interesting points. I wanted to bring you in on this point.
Please.
Advaita? I think there's some sort of a sound issue. I think she's not able to hear. But anyways, to take the discussion forward, something that I wanted to talk about was what Pramod was referring to on the social activities, right? Pramod, what were you saying about the social sector?
In general, a lot of Sangha-affiliated organizations, and you see them internationally as well, doing independent work, whether it is rescue, rehabilitation work, whether it is child welfare, whether it is schools in tribal areas. A lot of case studies in terms of stories. Now, this can be actual people who were beneficiaries of the work done by the Sangha to start talking about it, to start writing about it. In general, literature is all about creation of a lot of stories that come and generated around people who have interacted directly with the Sangha rather than Sangha themselves talking about it. So a literature creation unit should always be active in getting these stories out. That is what my main concern has always been.
You're right. Insofar as the service activity conducted in Nepal, the first thing I would like to keep the records right here. No person other than me from India or Bharat had been to Nepal during the earthquake and the relief work immediately in the immediate aftermath of the earthquake.
Right.
So thing is, we have not sent any swayamsevaks from India to Nepal. That was the wrong thing to understand. In Nepal, Hindu swayamsevak Sangh has been active, and there are branches of Vishwa Hindu Parishad, Pragdeep Vidyarthi Parishad, and other organizations. My presence was there to only to coordinate those things and how best from India we can get the relief material, and also to see that the government of India they extended a lot of relief activity, how best we can coordinate and to see that it reaches to the real sufferers. That was the role we played, and we are happy about it. But as Pramod is putting it, how RSS is pursued by others. For example, there are millions of people who have been beneficiaries of the seva activity by the Sangha Swayamsevaks all over India. Hmm. What they say about that, there is no proper documentation that is done. Hmm. So, what others feel about RSS, even those people who appreciate RSS, who are in a way supporters of RSS, from their point of view, that has to be documented and it should be presented. So these things have also been listed in our next 2-3 years of literature creation. So this we have taught. See, for example, RSS Vision in Action, a book was published some 20 years back. And it was the second edition of that book came out 10 years ago. We have now planned that there will be 6 volumes of this book. That is because a lot of work has taken place since then. So that's why we are going to come out in the next new year, that is 2017. There will be 6 volumes are going to be published about the various activities, that is RSS Vision in Action.
Interesting. Now that Advaita is back, we did not no hangout is complete without some technical issue, right? Advaita, can you hear me? Her connection is a little bad, so it keeps on it keeps on fluctuating. But regardless, we'll come to her when she's able to talk. But you know, the Indian media always speculates about one thing, and it has speculated for the last 20 years about the relationship between the BJP and the RSS, and then they put their own assumptions, draw their own conclusions.
I liked the rebuttal that Dattaji gave at India Today Conclave, where he said the journalist said, is there a remote control? And Dattaji said, there is a remote, meaning the distance. The distance is far. That the RSS is very remote to what BJP does. I loved that rebuttal. Uh-huh. So, can you talk about that a little bit as to why this speculation comes again and again? As to, I know that swayamsevaks are there in every political party in India. There is no question about it. But specifically between the Sangha and the BJP, why is this a pet discussion topic, Dattaji?
Probably it is not unusual. We have never shied away by telling that we have nothing to do with BJP. From day one, we have been on record, we have been repeatedly telling that BJP belongs to the ideological family of the Sangha, number one. And the relation is a relation of the umbilical cord relation. We have never hidden it. Neither the BJP. The thing is, why BJP was created out of Janata Party after merging Janson? See, for 2 years, experimentation of Janata Party ended. It was a sort of story. I do not want to go into that. But the thing is, BJP was created because the Janata Party people said that you, as well as Janson members, you cannot have any relation with RSS whatsoever. And on this count, the RSS members, the RSS swayamsevaks, they said, no, it is our freedom to have our relation with a cultural and social organization. So that's why the very inception of BJP is because of the Janata Party leaders who are not from Janson background. They wanted to put a ban on the connection between the RSS and the erstwhile Janson members. So that is why, how can we hide this fact? It is a fact of history that BJP was created because of their relation with Sangh. Only thing is whether the RSS is trying to control or to have a backseat driving the RSS. Or as if that every ministry in the government of Narendra Modi is being controlled, regulated, guided by RSS. See, RSS is the last organization to do that. Because RSS has always been nothing to hide. We are in public life. We are a democratic organization. And RSS has every right to suggest to any government and for the any government in democracy to take or leave suggestions of an organization like RSS. RSS is a prominent organization in this country. Should we not make suggestions to the government? What is wrong in that? We have been passing resolutions all through these years. So we have been meeting even the Congress governments. We have made suggestions. So that's why the BJP connection with RSS is as Pramod ji told, because of Swayamsevaks. Lot of Swayamsevaks are in BJP. Now coming to the other thing, why other, because other political parties have closed doors to the RSS Swayamsevaks. If you are in RSS, you should not be an active member in the political party. If they have closed the doors, the RSS Swayamsevaks who are having political inclination, where they should go?
Interesting. Now, before we lose Advaita again, I wanted to come in now. So, Advaita. And we lost her again. It's like as soon as I go to her, we lose her.
And in general, Dattaji, in the...
Go on, Advaita.
I missed part of the conversation. I'm sorry because of a bad connection, but someone was talking about books when I cut off. And earlier, Shadri was mentioned, so I just wanted to recommend this book, which is RSS Vision in Action. So I'm plugging a book, but okay, you did, okay. So I'm plugging a book, not mine, but it's a very good book to read.
And
then because you have flashed a book, I will also do one thing. This is Karyakarta. This is by Thengdi ji. And Shati, this is going to be in English also. This is a wonderful book to understand the basic concept of Sangh's ideology, its working system, and the Karyakartas are the workers that have been produced by RSS. So this book is going to be shortly appearing in English as well.
Very interesting. This should be sent to all the people, all the quote unquote intellectuals who always criticize about books not coming out from the RSS. So, but Advaita, you had some questions and some comments about the recent events and so forth that you were talking about the conclave. And so looks like her connection is pretty bad. Lost her again. But anyways, to move the to keep the discussion going, what was Pramod? You were saying something about the economics, right?
I want to talk about Indonomics, Dattaji. That has been my practice as a businessman as well. And I have read upon Dattaupan Thengdi ji's discourses in books written by others as to how a businessman should look at Purushartha and how Indica values enable you to generate revenue, but also with a different way of looking at things. Can we talk about the economic vision that Sangha sees for India in the future with the world very... I would say confused state right now. Either they are going against so-called crony capitalism. Earlier, the division was capitalism and socialism. Now, apparently, there is crony capitalism and far-left socialism. They are so confused. Can we offer something as an alternative to the world in the near future with India as a fulcrum?
Yeah. See, certainly the third way that was suggested by Dattaupan Thengdi ji was exactly this. The extreme capitalism or the crony capitalism on one side and the so-called left or the communist ideology insofar as economics is concerned, See, these two are the extreme philosophies. They are not going to give succor to the humankind and less to the Indians. Because, see, the thing is, any society cannot have these extreme ideas of things. There has to be a perfect balance, number one. And all these laissez-faire theory, that is, the on which the capitalism and free enterprise are founded, and also the communist philosophy or the Marxism, Marxian economics, they had two, three things basics. One is the production, the management, the ownership, the distribution of all of the wealth. The only thing is who owns the wealth. That is the major thing. Whether the individual or the society, or in the name of society, the government, and in the name of government, a small clique. That is what is happening in the communist countries, in totalitarian regimes. So that's why the third way that is suggested by Dattopan Jengdi is essentially Hindu view. See, there will be some areas where you will have to open up yourself to the wider world because you cannot close the doors. That is necessary. And on the other, there has to be essentially indigenous way of economic thinking. That is, what is the national interest for any country? It is how you best utilize your resources, human resources, natural resources, both. But unfortunately, in India, what has happened in independent India is the human resources were not properly trained to tap the natural resources in the way that it can be used for the nation's development. So that is why now the skill development is the key word. So now the people are feeling that the skill development is the boon. So there is the human resources, number one. Natural resources, there has been exploitation. So that is why the on the other side, the special economic zone, etc., were opposed by Swadeshi Jagran Manch and people. That's again for the same reason. And third thing is, the people getting job anywhere, any part of the country, that is not, see, localized, that is cottage industries, rural industries, they are to be developed. Mahatma Gandhi also said that you uproot the people from Kerala have to go for jobs to remote parts of other, for example, or BREs, they have to find jobs in Mumbai or in Punjab. So this is going to destroy the social and cultural fabric of the society. So these things also should be taken into consideration while you are making your economic policies work. So this is all what the Sangha has been doing. And as far as technology is concerned, Deen Dayalji was very emphatic about how the technology is. He said economy, ecology, and this thing. He said three things, ethics, economy, and ecology. See, when you use the technology, Aditi,
No. I was just agreeing with you. Interesting point.
Yeah. Yes, that is, technology, humane technology should be adopted. The many a time it is said that Sangha is against new technologies. It is a misnomer. See, Sangha has always been using technologies, and we are not against it. We are not opposed to it. But technology for economic development, for the nation's development, it should be developed in such a way that we should take into account the economy of the country. That is, when you have a technology of any kind, then the economy should not get disturbed. That means you should also provide jobs for hands, for minds. Though only machines cannot do the work, and it should not. Udyogam purusha lakshanam. That is why the human beings should be provided with the right kind of job for their hands and for their minds. Number two, ecology, that I have already covered. The environmental issues, environmental care has to take is when you are adopting any technology. The entire West is suffering because of this technology and the environmental crossfire. Number three, that is about ethics. So the ethical management of technology has not been well addressed in the last several decades. We have been, let's say, for example, cloning is let us say. So the entire Western world is thinking whether human cloning is right or wrong. So that means ethical question is there. So these are three things have to be there. So this is essentially, these are the things which Sangh has been emphasizing upon.
Interesting. I'm going to promote just, I think Advaita just joined again. I'm going to try and see if we can get through her. Advaita, can you hear us? Hello? Not quite. Yeah, Pramod, go ahead.
Dattaji, I have always been of the belief that as a small business owner with about 25-30 employees that I could generate with my wherewithal, I've always felt that the government of the day should incentivize a company in terms of taxation and job creation. So if an employer is able to generate 1,000 employees, with whatever capabilities that employer has, that should be rewarded in terms of tax concessions over a period of time. Again, right now what is happening is that reward is coming in form of land, and people are creating unnecessary jobs in the thirst for land. So I have seen some state governments in India allocate acres of land if you are able to create 1,000 employees. That should not be the criteria. As it is, industrialists are very fond of land, creating a land bank. That is a wrong incentive. The incentive should be that you create 10,000 employees, your next few years, there will be much more tax concessions given to you in terms of number of employees created. So it is a very humanistic and holistic, and I agree with you on ethics and ecology. This is a very big thesis, and I would certainly want to write about my experience in as a small businessman.
I have a slight disagreement with Pramod, but we'll take that disagreement a little later. We've already had a big debate on economics on this, but time is of the essence. So I wanted to move on to the social issues part that we were talking about. That there are very sad occurrences all across India where we see, especially recently, there were two cases of RSS workers being killed in Kerala. And in the most brutal fashion. And sadly, these killings do not make the national news because, you know, as I said, there is some sort of ideological apartheid with the RSS, so they don't take that. So, do you see there is an increase in such events, targeted events against the RSS workers, Dattaji? And is the RSS doing something to, you know, have a correction measure or something like that against it? Like more security or so forth?
The thing is that the land of Kerala and some parts of eastern states like Bengal and northeastern states, and also the Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, these have been the areas in Tamil Nadu where the politics of violence has been there, and RSS has been the victim of it. And we have lost the precious lives of more than 250 of our karyakartas in several decades. And the recent thing what you have referred to is really a very unfortunate and shocking thing. That the who relieved his office, who is a candidate in the Kerala's upcoming assembly election, V. Muralidharan and others have been attacked. Muralidharan has been the National General Secretary of BJP, and he was a two-term president of BJP in the Kerala state. See, the thing is, as you said, these things do not make news. The other day, I talked to India Today reporter. I told him, see, if any such murder should make a news. I don't say if it is somebody else's, it should not make a news, but some news make the headlines, whereas the political killings or political attacks of this kind, they are not making national news, and nobody is crying for the intolerance that is being exhibited in such a way all over the Kerala state, particularly in northern part and the recent. Now the thing is security. I tell you, the ideological killings of RSS Swayamsevaks in Kerala has been following a method. Whenever the CPM was in power, the attacks were more. And they had the machinery, government machinery, to cover up themselves. But this time we have been seeing, because in the recent elections of the local bodies and in the last parliament election, in Kerala, BJP has made a very recognizable progress. That's why they have now afraid that in the upcoming assembly election, there may be entry of BJP MLA into the Vidhan Sabha of Kerala. So they are afraid, because now 19 plus percent of voting was there in the last local body elections. So the CPM, which is afraid of the BJP's growth, has attacked the BJP workers who are saying so themselves also. As far as security is concerned, we have always believed that our karyakartas, our workers, they take care of these things, and the society also take care. And we have been demanding the government to take measures. Of course, we have our own organizational and security measures. However, these things do happen, which is unfortunate.
Dattaji, if this was happening anywhere else in the world, an organization was getting attacked, there would have been hundreds and thousands of books, literature printed, called atrocity literature, where even though 250 people were killed, another couple of zeros would have gotten added to it, and posters pasted all over with the victims, and a huge echo chamber created of persecution. Unfortunately, that is the way the world operates, with even a few people getting affected by that kind of violence. And that is why one of my earlier topics was about the documenting such things, and also creating documentaries and materials that will be used for wider research and dissemination. So
we have published Martyrdom of Swayamsevaks a few years ago, and it was launched in the India Habitat Center of New Delhi by L.K. Advaniji 10 years ago. And we have made a directory of the people who have been killed in different states of India by the Maoists, extremists, jihadists, and all. We have documented and we have published that.
Okay. Can we talk a little bit on the challenges that Sangh faces in the rural areas? Now, there are two schemes that I have
And
research.
To add on to it, Pramodin, then you can phrase your question. Also, about, you were talking about women in RSS as well, right, Pramod? So just together a question, we wanted to phrase it the same way.
This goes in as an extension to what you had spoken at the India Today Conclave. Now, there are two schemes that the Sashastra Gram, Sashastra Hindu, and Rajmarg Sampark Yojana, that has been a long pending endeavor by the Sangha. Have you faced challenges that every typical social cultural organization faces in the village, which is the kind of deep divisions that exist? And what does Sangha do to overcome such things? Are there any specific things that...
At least in the last several years, Sangha, except for a short period in the immediate aftermath of the Mahatma Gandhi's assassination, RSS has never been facing any such thing. In some parts of Northeast, of course, we did face the local opposition by the people for the expansion of Sangh work, other two created by some Western interests.
Correct.
Other Sangha is not facing any of these things. We have been working, and as you taken up this expansion into rural area, etc. The problem is not of opposition by any group. That Sangha Karyakartas will take care of. We are ready to face it. And if there is opposition, we are growing there. That is what has happened in Kerala. Kerala is having the maximum number of shakas now. And recently, you know very well that more than 1 lakh people in Sangha uniform were there. that is not a problem for Sangh at all. The problem is of the bickering within the Hindu society in the name of caste and communities, and this is the problem. Because Sangha is an organized Hindu society. The casteism and untouchability, and unfortunately the elections, the kind of elections that are being held in India, the Vidhan Sabha elections, Lok Sabha elections, Lokasabha elections, everywhere, when the caste is so much discussed, and even the media gives out the percentage of people who are belonging to particular community and caste. So this caste is always 24/7. It is there in the minds of the people. That's why that is the biggest hindrance for the Sangh's expansion, if at all there is any.
And I have one, so Advaita could not join the video call or something, but she has been able to hear our conversation, and I told her to message me a question and a comment that she had. So I'm going to read out what she just sent me. So this is going to be like the news editors reading their viewers right now. And Advaita is probably going to kill me for just making that reference. But she made a very interesting point that there were a lot of historical inaccuracies that were being spread about the Sangh. So she wanted to know that, how does the Sangh plan to combat the historical inaccuracies? And do you? She does believe that the and from based on her conversations that a lot of the people in the Sangh believe that the work should speak for itself. But is there going to be a more assertive rebuttal of these historical inaccuracies? You think that Taji?
Yes, it will be there with the people, supporters like Advaita and Adi. If you are with us, definitely we will be doing it more often, and of course within Sangha also, I tell you, many Sangha Swayamsevaks are now taking up to writings, the Facebook, the bloggers, and in social media and in the mainstream media. The Sangha Swayamsevaks are now, enough is enough, now we have to take up this ideological struggle with the weapons and instruments that are to be used. So that's why there is a new breed in Sangha movement who are now adept in this, and they are going to take up.
Interesting points. Pramod, any closing comments? We'll start wrapping this up in the last, this is the last 5 minutes. So yes, Pramod.
Many people who have not been privy to Sangha, have not gone to a shaka, or never been part of anything to do with Sangha, are at this point in time very puzzled and enthused by it in a positive sense about what Sangh really is about. Because possibly because it has given two prime ministers and many chief ministers, governors, vice presidents, and so on and so forth. But many people want to know, is Sangh a finishing school? Is Sangh a extension of your mother and father? Is Sangh a teaching is it teaching curriculum that is not being taught in schools? What is it, do you think, Dattaji, with your varied experience within the Sangha, quantifies a Swayamsevak, and why people should look at trying to be at least part of some arm of, or the other of the Sangha?
No, last thing I did not hear.
What is it in a Swayamsevak that is special, or what is it in the Swayamsevak that makes his contribution endearing to so many people? Can you tell about some qualities? Can you tell about some
what is Swayamsevakatva or Swayamsevakhood? That itself is the thing. See, the new people who have not been into Shaka, still they are impressed or attracted to Sangha people. It is because of the way the Sangha Swayamsevaks behave, they interact with the people. One thing is because of the Sangha training and Sangha background, the Sangha Swayamsevaks are their honesty of purpose, I think. That is the one very important thing. Second thing is the general simplicity that is there, and the hard work and sincerity that they have been exhibiting in their work. So, for example, in the recent Chennai flood, what happened? the Swayamsevaks of Sangh were not allowed to take out route march a few months back. The Tamil Nadu police denied permission. We had to move to the court to get the permission for to take out our route march. But the same police, when the Swayamsevaks went with wearing Sangh's khaki shorts, and they went to help the suffering people, the same police said that nobody else should come, only the Sangha Swayamsevaks should come. That means that the police also know that it is the Sangha people, when they come for the this work, their work will be spotless, and they are going to help the really suffering people. So there are a teen number of such examples. Uttarakhand tsunami, etc. I can tell. Even about the rural development work. Even about the social equality and social justice, I tell you. The people believe if the Sangh takes up the work of social harmony and social equality to eradicate untouchability, then many of the people who belong to scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, they feel that these people are honest in their approach. So I think the Swayamsevak's honesty of purpose, their behavior, the simplicity, the mingling, that is the thing that has made Sangh endear to others.
That's an interesting point, especially about the eliminating the caste system. The and Pramod can correct me, I can't recall, but the Ek Samshan, Ek thing in the campaign that goes on in the village, that is, you know, a Ek Kuwa, Ek Samshan. Yeah, that's a very interesting campaign.
One temple. Entry for all in the temple, common water source, and common cremation ground.
So this is, if my friend Sunanda was on the call, she would have asked this question. That's one of her, she's been wanting to ask. So so I will do that. I will ask that question on her behalf. And also, and another interesting thing that you said about the khaki shorts. Now we are having the RSS is going to change the uniforms. I used to ask Pramod a lot of times that this change may have come 20 years too late, but it finally has come. And I'm glad the RSS is evolving on this. So I wonder if this is the RSS 2.0 that we are going to see in the next 5 years of time.
Definitely, I think, I hope, may your wish come true. One thing is about the social equality thing, I tell you, the Sangha has started this particular campaign and movement silently, because in Hindu society, the efforts to eradicate untouchability is not new. Sangha does not say that we are the pioneers and nobody else has done it. We are the last person to say that. But why that has failed? Because the great leaders laid some examples, but unfortunately the society has not followed. That is why to change the minds of the ordinary people and the women in the house, the people working in the various walks of life, unless they accept this as part of their article of faith, this is not going to happen. And the Sangha does not want to make up big slogans and put a big leader and he will declare that no, from here, now onwards, there will be no untouchability, etc. It is not going to happen. So that is why in the recent Pratinidhi Sabha resolution, we adopted a resolution that is how we can practice this social harmony and deny this refusing to practice the untouchability. So that has to come into practice. That is why Sangha has taken up this, but it will be a very silent campaign, but definitely a social revolution.
Interesting. No, and especially, are we also going to see more women take up more proactive roles in the RSS going forward?
Women are already there in various aspects.
No, I know. More and more, like, you increased participation.
Sure. Why not? They will be.
That's what I was saying. I am aware of the women's wing and so forth. But you know, this is something that we wanted to ask as well. Sunanda wanted to ask as well, that if we're going to see an increased involvement in the decision making.
So RSS organization, whether there will be office bears, that is not the thing now. That is the question before us. The RSS continues to have its constitution as it is there, it will be there. But only the participation of women will increase, and in all those activities which are taking place, women are also decision makers. And all those activities, except the Shaka activity, women are also the part and parcel of the decision making team in the RSS, inspired hundreds of activities in the name of RSS.
Interesting. Now, I'm glad Dattaji set the record straight on that, because as I said, a lot of misinformation is being spread. But with that, we're getting to the concluding point. Pramod, any closing remarks before I go to Dattaji for the last remarks? Because we want to...
What kind of relationships should the four Indic religions have in the future, and what will Sangha do to facilitate a continuous, ongoing and sustainable dialogue between the four religions? Can you talk about that a little bit, Dattaji?
Yeah.
That will be my closing question.
Indic religions, which are generally the parliament of religion, that is Hinduism, that is the broad name. Even Swami Vivekananda and Gandhiji, when they said Hindu, they included all these things. That is why it is not the first time that Sangha is speaking about it. So the thing is, there should be more attraction. Only thing is Buddhism and Sikhism. Sikhism in the recent past, because of certain Western interests, there have been some gaps and bickerings between the Sikh community and the rest of the society. Okay. It is a political machination, and a large section of Sikh community, they are having very good relation with the rest of the Hindu society. I do not think there is any disbelief or mistrust in these communities. Only thing is, there should be more, instead of this so-called interfaith dialogue, etc., these things are Western ways of doing things. See, in Hindu way, those things, these dialogues and interface, etc., this is not going to take us anywhere. It is in the socio-cultural arena, we should have more and more of cultural, social activities instead of discussing it on the dais. That will, see, for example, in the Guru Purab, Guru Nanak Jayanti, procession will be there. Or Guru Gobind Singh, 350th year celebrations will be there this year. The Sangha has already issued a statement that in such programs, the large number of people should participate. The real participation at the people level in various socio-cultural activities and also the service activities. Recently, in this connection, I'll take one more minute. That is, we have been organizing a Hindu social and spiritual fair.
I see.
This Hindu spiritual and social fair, in the name of Hindu social activity, that is the seva activities, Hindu spiritual and seva fair, this I conducted in Chennai, Jaipur, recently in Bangalore, and some more cities we will be having in the next year. There, all these seva activities conducted by various Sikh, Jain, Buddhist and Sanatani and other organizations and mathas and ashrams and very religious organizations and movements, they are all participating under one name of Hindu spiritual and seva fair.
Okay.
So these type of activities will definitely make them come together instead of interfaith dialogue and all.
On a lighter note, Dattaji, we have our own interfaith dialogue on Mind Makers, because I am a Jain and Pramod is a Hindu, and we always have a discussion on it. So there is we have our own private Indic religions interfaith dialogue.
Definitely, that is there. Beauty of Hinduism is that you will retain your identity, but you also become the part of the whole.
We always joke that we are probably two sides of the same coin, because we agree on 95% of the things anyways. So
why not?
Absolutely. No, so and in case our viewers are wondering, we've tried to cover everything we could in the last 35-40 minutes. Sorry if we couldn't cover everything you wanted. We were not going to get into the trap of breaking news, because we wanted to have a very intellectual discussion, and unlike other channels, we don't want to just have one line answers which are quoted out of context. So we wanted to have that. So I would I'm really sorry about the technical difficulties with Advaita. She was on for another she was on for 5 minutes, but sadly we couldn't get her on. But we'll get her on in the near future. She's definitely going to be part of some more Mindmakers discussion. But till then, I would really thank Dattaji for joining us. It was a wonderful interaction.
Thank you.
Pramod had.
I will think of writing some of these things so that in the next a couple of months or so, if something of these things are there on paper and printed or on the internet, that will be better than instead of because Pramodya has been repeatedly reminding me of creating literature. Let me try.
Absolutely. Yeah, we would love to. I'm really looking forward to reading that. So, absolutely. Till then, please like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter. Thank you for tuning in. We'll be back soon with the next edition of Mind Debates. Till then, it's a good day.
Thank you. All the best. My best greetings for the Diwali, for the Holi festival.
Thank you so much, Dattaji. And we wish you the same for Holi. Hope every festival is as glorious as as the one coming up. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Pramodji. Thank you.